Ah, I have access.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good evening if you're in Europe. Good morning in the States. And welcome to the very special February 2023 presentation of the Denver Area Access Users Group. As we do three times a year, we meet in the mornings so that we may have the pleasure of having a live presentation from our Access colleagues in Europe. And today we have the immense pleasure of joining with Karl Donaubauer, who will be presenting on the current state of access. Karl is a longtime MVP going back to last century, late 90s, I assume, but last century sounds even better. Karl does a lot of writing. He hosts or publishes regularly in Access News every few months. He's an MVP. Very active in the community. He hosts two conferences in Europe, one in German and one in English, and I'm sure he'll be able to talk about those. But for now, Karl, I would like to welcome you, the singing cowboy of the Austrian Alps, the international man of mystery, the data farmer of the Danube, Mr. Karl Donaubauer. Welcome to the Denver Area Access Users Group, and thank you for joining us.
Thanks, George, for the introduction. Good evening, good morning, or whatever you have in your zone. Today I'm talking about the current state of access, and these are some of the chapters below here, statistics, market, etc. It's 52 slides, so we have a lot to cover. And yeah, on the right side below, you see my reference to Colorado as I see it. Cowboys, skiing, bulls, etc. Scorpions, I think, somewhere, yeah. That's Colorado. I've never been there, maybe one time after the pandemic or whenever. So let's start over. The first thing is I want to talk about my general view about the market of access, about the technology of access. So first general, and then we go into several details. Generally, I would say there are a lot of minuses in terms of access market and technology. And I always want to be realistic in how I see access. So I'll start with the minuses. With access, we are Windows bound, we are desktop bound, and COM based and bound. So it's old technology, outdated technology, not only from the view of Microsoft, but generally seen. We don't have web and mobile capabilities in access. All of you, I think, will have seen that the attempts of Microsoft to build something with access in this direction, nothing worked. We don't have any administration tools. That's why IT departments and administrators hate us, generally. Not all, but almost all. We don't have real security features, or just a very few and weak ones, database, password, etc., but that's it. We have an awful lot of update bugs. And instability in the access applications because of these update bugs. And the result is a big trust crisis in the last years. I will go into detail later. Microsoft almost neglects the product. There are very few resources, very few new features, almost no PR for access because it's not an important product anymore. We have a bad image. We have constant death rumors since 20 years or so. But yeah, you see there are reasons for the death rumors. I will go into this later too. Access is nowhere to find in schools and education. My daughter has got an iPad in school and she has Office on it, but no access, of course. So that's a problem with getting young and fresh blood into the access market and into the access development. There are modern technologies, of course, mobile, etc., and modern form factors and modern demands for applications. And that's why the market for desktop databases is slowly declining for 20 years or so. So the market for access is declining and for our developments. And for all these points that I listed here, no improvements are to be expected. It becomes worse and worse. So I see at my conferences where there are hundreds of people that people age, people impoverish, they retire, they die. So that's the current situation of us access developers. You see, I see it quite realistic, I think. And so why are we still here? We have a German saying, an old one, ist der Ruf erst ruiniert, dann lebt er sich ganz ungeniert. And in English, that would be something like, once the reputation is ruined, life is quite easy. Or to say it shorter, we don't give a damn. That's my advice for you, because there are also plus sides with access. I think that the desktop database applications are here to stay, and also the market is here to stay. And there are a lot of reasons for this persistence, despite all the minuses that are listed. People need rich local applications for some kind of work and some kind of departments, etc. And another reason is the sheer size and scope. I mean, people have 100 controls on their application on one page, and that's for a reason. Nobody wants to do his accounting on the mobile. So there are a lot of niches where access will prevail. Another reason would be data protection, to have local data. We have the GDPR here in Europe. At your side, it would be HIPAA or whatever. So there are data protection reasons to keep things and data local. The efficiency and availability through local resources. I mean, we always see the promotion that Azure, et cetera, and Amazon Web Services are more secure, more available. And a few weeks ago, half a day, we didn't have anything from Microsoft. There was a complete interruption. So, I mean, and efficiency, you can copy and paste an access database with just a few strokes on your computer or with a mouse, few mouse clicks. You can't do that with a web database. So there are reasons for this, that we will stay here. And there's an unbeatable return on investment. I mean, I don't go into all the details, you know them, because you are quicker with access, you are cheaper with access, and if you have to do the same thing or a similar thing in the web, it's always three times longer, three times more difficult, and three times more expensive or something like that, a factor like that. And so the last sentence here is programmed for me. The market segment for this little smaller database applications, I think it will continue to decline as it has over the last 20 years, but I don't see it disappear. So we go to niches with access, more and more of big niches. And inside of this market, in this market, access has about 90% in the Windows sector of the market. So there is no real competition in terms of capability and distribution. Microsoft, a program manager a few years ago, told us about 11 million monthly users. I don't know how exact these figures are, but there are millions out at least. And it is still present at most big companies. Not at all. They try to get rid of it, some of them, but it's not so easy. They sometimes have 10,000 access databases around the big companies. And it is indispensable for the smaller companies. And we have some remedies, some workarounds for the minuses that are listed. We can have an online backend. We can have the complete application hosted. The link here at hosting goes to George Young's presentation a few months ago about access in an Azure virtual machine. And we can have hybrid applications. The link here goes to an article of mine about hybrid application with SharePoint and Power Apps, etc., so that you have it on your mobile phone, parts of the database. And the big part is in Access and SQL, etc. So there are possibilities for us to at least reach into the modern form factors, etc., and the modern needs. And there are third-party tools, a lot of third-party tools. I will talk about it later in detail, and community initiatives to improve this situation. And I think in a few years, and already now, I have some of these people telling me that their expertise slowly becomes more and more valuable. I think on the COBOL situation, where all the airports still have COBOL programs from the 60s and the 70s. I think with access, with millions of access databases out there, your expertise, if you stay in the market, will become more and more valuable. I already see this sometimes in the market. All these points, all these items that are listed here, there are almost no hard facts to find anywhere for access. There is almost no market research. At least I'm not aware of anything. But my findings come from conferences. I mean, I'm probably the access guy in the world who knows the most access developers because of my conferences. I know hundreds of them in person. I talk to them. Hundreds of times every year. And of course, I have my own customer base, my order situation, and it's a good one. I can send myself two or three times nowadays. And another sign that there are many, many people still in the access market are bug threads in forums. The last point here. What I mean by this is the forums for access, they go down in the last 15 or 20 years. They are just a tiny part of what they were 20 years ago. But that doesn't necessarily mean that there are no more people out. I mean, if you throw in, or if you are part of a discussion in a forum, you see maybe a dozen views or so. And if it's a big forum, you may see 100 views or 200 views listed there. But if it comes to bugs, you see this kind of thing here. So if it's really urgent, 5,000 views, 32,000 views. So if there are really urgent bugs, people come in. Why is this? I think it is because there are almost no new technologies, no new things to learn in access in the last 15 or 20 years, so that people don't have to come into forums and ask their questions, just a tiny part of them. There are so many sources out there in the web. But if there is no source, if it is urgent, really, people become active. Generally, access people are passive, but I see this. These are discussions from the last months and bugs from the last months. And you see the results here, 20,000, 30,000 views. So thousands of people who came into the threads. So there are a lot of people and developers and people who work seriously with access, but we don't see them. That's the problem often. Yeah. A week ago, not even a week, a few days ago, we had a discussion in a mail group with MVPs. One of the MVPs had a customer, a client, who told him, the IT department told him, access is going away. It is going to be deprecated. And he was asked to tell them his meaning and his findings about access. And he asked us, and I found some links, etc. I collected some links and gave it to him. And I want to give it to you because we have these death rumors for years now. I mean, you go into a forum, you see articles where people say access is being dropped, or you have a client in IT department that tells you that access is being dropped. And you have to tell them something. You have to prove that that's not the case. And so I went and found some links at Microsoft, and you will get these slides. I sent them to George, and you can use them in these cases. And they happen quite often. I think everybody has heard this, seen this. The first part is about Access and Microsoft 365. The first one is the general landing page of Microsoft. Let me go there. It's when you type in Microsoft Access in Google or Bing or wherever, in all search machines, you get to this side of Microsoft. And what you see here is just some PR. You can do everything with Access. You don't have to have any skills. Access does the usual PR. And there is no word about deprecation here. On the contrary, buy it for home, buy it for business. So this is the first thing. Microsoft sells Access actively, at least at this page. I will come to some details later. The second one is Access is listed among the Microsoft 365 apps. If you go to the right plans, I go to the big plans here. If they come up, yes. These are E3, E5, F3, etc. And Access is listed here among the Microsoft 365 apps. we are in the second row, as usually, even behind publisher, but we have our own row. You have to see it like this. But we are listed here. So we are actively listed in the newest, in the latest Microsoft 365 things they want to sell to people. The third one is a support matrix, a PDF, where you can read that M365 apps have no end date on Win 11, etc. I don't go into every detail here. This is the most important link. It's the lifecycle entry for Access 2021. If I go to it, you'll see that there is the end of the support is in October 26. So we have 3.5 years of guarantee that Access has to work in Windows, that it, bugs get fixed, that new features get added. And this is the so-called modern lifecycle policy. Essentially, that means in former years, you had 10 years of support. Now you have 5 years of support. That's modern lifecycle policy in short. But that's the same date for all Office 21. So that's the latest perpetual version of Office. And you can tell the people that say Access is being dropped, no. The next 3.5 years, we have some evidence from Microsoft, hard evidence here. Next one is Microsoft has committed itself that there will be another perpetual version after 21. I don't go into the point here, but it leads you to item 4 there, and they said another Office version will come out. And as there is no sign of deprecation for Access, we can assume that we will have an Access 23 or 24 whenever the next perpetual version comes out, and that we will have another 5 years of modern lifecycle policy. So it's only 3 years because we are waiting. Later this year, maybe we get 23, and then we have another 5 years to show to people. And the last one here is actually from the talk. There was a talk session in November, and the Access team was a guest there. And George Hepworth asked, what shall we answer if people tell us Access is being dropped? And the principal engineering manager, so the chief of the Access engineers, Dale Rector, said about 2 or 3 minutes, that's the exact link to the video. He said, no, nothing, doesn't know anything about deprecation. He builds new features, they are actively developing, they are a small department, but they develop and they are not going to deprecate Access. So you can even play them something audible, the people that have this. Tell you this. And another important point is, have the claimant who tells you Access being dropped say what are his sources and his evidence. And that's the point where you win the discussion, because they have nothing, because there is nothing. They have heard something, they think because of the situation and blah, blah, blah. So if you have this slide, you win every discussion, I think. That's the point here. Are there any questions, George, so far?
Yes, there is one question in chat. It's totally off topic. What do you use to zoom your screen in and out? Do you zoom it by sysinternals or something else?
No, it's Zoom It, the tool by Microsoft.
Beautiful. Thank you. That's all we have so far, Karl.
Oh, people already sleep. Okay, let me go forward. Next chapter is about Microsoft. What has Microsoft brought us? So during, I go back a year or so to 22 until right now. The situation. What have we got from Microsoft last year? Well, the first part is update bugs. So this is a list of the 22 update bugs, not all of them. There were other minor bugs. It's just the list I choose. 12 bugs, so for every month about one bug. And maybe you are familiar with one or the other here. So we get an awful lot of update bugs in 22, and we still get them. Just let you for a few seconds here, maybe you recognize one or the other and you have seen it at yourself, at clients, etc. So many update bugs coming out with the updates of Microsoft. By the way, there are a lot of links up here and you'll get the slide deck, and this leads you in this example to the fixes and workaround page of Microsoft, where you see most of these bugs listed and some workarounds or fixes if there are. So what I want to say here is we get a lot of update bugs. since years. And there was some surprise. Sometimes there I see some surprise if they get fixed very quickly in a few days. It doesn't happen all too often, but there are occurrences from quick fixes. And you don't get any new version. You don't get an update. There is no information, no transparency. Why is that? I just want to explain this version. It's unusual, but it happens for a part of these bugs. And the reason is the so-called change and feature gates. Microsoft says about this change and feature gates that when they ship changes out, when they do updates, and they make changes, they try to wrap them into something that's called change gate or feature gate. And when then you open an Office app, it calls home. Like ET, it calls home to Microsoft, and it determines at home at Microsoft if the code it's wrapping should be executed or not. And if they find a regression, an update bug at Microsoft, they change a setting at Redmond. And when the user, when you restart the app, then this issue is resolved. It's switched off. That's the simple explanation for change or feature gate. That's the case when they find the bug quickly and when they can turn it off by change or feature gate. Unfortunately, usually a bug has phases like this and it doesn't go away in a few days, but like this here. First they roll out the update, and they roll out 100 million updates with Office or so, many millions. I think it's about 100 million or so they roll out, and they have to do it over several days. That's why you don't get it always on Tuesday, on the first day, but it may last a few days because otherwise the servers would break down and the internet would have a problem. The second phase, when there is some bug out, your client is calling, some department in your company is calling, a colleague, and saying, hey, my Access application doesn't work anymore, something doesn't work in it anymore. So there starts a clarification phase of several days. You go to web forums, we have a mail list with MVPs where we try to clarify things with the Access team. Many discussions, etc., and it needs some days. Sometimes it even needs a few weeks to clarify if it's really an update bug or not. So this is a positive numbering here that I have. It may also be 4 weeks, but I analyzed the update bugs from 2019 onwards, and usually it's this one, more on the bigger side of these numbers, so 4 days or so. But sometimes it takes weeks. Then the people get alarmed because they have a standstill, a big problem, and they begin to shout, when will Microsoft do something? Yeah, I mean, everybody, I think, has seen this in the forums or shouted himself here. It's like rolling dices from the Microsoft side. If there is some information, if there is some workaround going out, because they have this bug page, this fixes and workaround page, but very often you don't see an article coming up there for days or even for weeks, or a workaround. Usually it the web forums are quicker. And people are shouting for a fix with every day that comes here. And the fix usually takes a week, but we had cases where it took 7 weeks because it depends on your version of Access, on your update channel that you're in, on the kind of bug you get. The security bug, for example, can take much longer than a bug that is inside of Access, or a Windows bug. Usually takes weeks and weeks before it can be fixed. And the last phase that I see is the fix information. As I said, you don't get the fix in the first day and automatically, or you may have switched off updates because of the fear that you get the fix back, the bug back again, if you don't turn off. So you need a fix information that it is out. And this also takes several days usually until you get the information by Microsoft. It takes, it can take many weeks and different phases here. And these phases usually all happen, longer or shorter. And so people pose, I'd say, fundamental questions. Why does this happen? And will it happen again? So for the why, I have some thoughts. I think the quality management is not the best, first one. The second one at Microsoft, They have shifted the bug testing to the customer more or less. I mean, there are beta channels, and then there are quick channels, a bit slower channels, and until you get to the final channel or to the 6 months channel with a delay, etc. But essentially, the way they throw out the updates, they shifted the responsibility to the customer. And it's a complex matter. I mean, it's not easy to do updates for hundreds of millions of people with thousands of different combinations of hardware and software, and with all the old dependencies to Windows, to Office, to old DLLs, et cetera, et cetera. So it's not a very easy matter also for Microsoft. That's another reason. And will it happen again? There's a clear answer, yes, it will happen again. We see it all the time, almost with every update, something comes out. And the second question people pose in the forums, et cetera, is why is everything so slow? I showed you the usual timetable for such a bug. In my point, it's the long-winded processes at Microsoft. It's not so easy for them to reproduce a bug, to find it, to fix it, and then to roll it out and to pull out the information. And in my point of view, they are the way they do it, this process, it's far from the customer needs, and especially from the Access customer needs, because Access is again different from the rest of Office. I mean, if there is a problem in Word, okay, you can write your letter or something, a mail march or whatever. And if there is a problem with something in Excel, you can't do a reporting, a calculation. That's a bad thing. But if something is wrong in Access, you can have a standstill of your whole company, because Access applications are usually bigger and more mission critical. And so these processes at Microsoft, they are even less pointed to our needs or adequate to our needs than to the rest of Office. And that's another problem for us Access people. Another question is that I often get, which version shall I use to not be so much affected by update bugs? And there are various philosophies. A lot of people use, for example, 2010, Access 2010, which is out of support and therefore doesn't get all the update bugs. Just a few of them, but not all of them. So this helps sometimes. Actually, the computer where I do the presentation here is equipped with Access 2010, my main tool to program with Access. I have 365 only on the virtual machine here because I don't trust it. The other philosophy is the contrary. Always get the newest. I mean, many companies and especially administrations, etc., have to have always the newest versions, 365 or at least one of these newer versions from 16, 19, 21 on. And if you take the newest versions from Microsoft, you get the bugs as the quickest and you get the quickest fixes. So it's an up and a downside. And the third thing you can do to in terms of avoiding update bugs or minimizing them is to use SQL Server as backend. This helps sometimes because a lot of the update bugs were for Access backends, but it doesn't help always. I will have some examples later where the problem was exactly ODBC or SQL Server. So there's no 100% guarantee with any of these things. It depends on what kind of applications you have, what is allowed in your organization, in your company, etc. What would be the best for you? And of course, the biggest question by all this is people ask, and companies, also big company ask, is Access trustworthy anymore and suitable for business critical things? And that's the trust crisis that I already mentioned. I will come back to this later, that we have because of these instabilities. So Karl was thinking last year about what can we do? What are the most urgent problems of Access? I had a little discussion with other MVPs, and the first question was this one. And the second was, what can I, as a little guy in little Austria, do to alleviate the problem? the problems that I came up with. And the number one problem was exactly this situation: update bugs, the lame, the missing information that I mentioned in this timetable, and the big trust crisis that we have in the access market. What I can do from my side, I set up a new website, accessforever.org. Let me go quickly there. And it's just a blog site, but it's not really just a blog site. What we tried there is to inform people much faster about upcoming and new update bugs. So I started this with some event, and then you may see here bugs. So it's a lot about bugs here. There's George Hepworth telling something about a bug. And in between, I mentioned some tools, and then we have bugs again, and bugs. So we covered the latest update bugs since December. The site is up since December. And we means that I don't do this alone, but I asked some people to join me in this effort to inform people fast and to accelerate these processes that I mentioned before. So you may know some guys here. And what we are doing is, if a new bug comes up in a forum, we have a little discussion and then immediately throw out an article about with the first findings. So to be quick, for people to have a reference, even if we don't know the real reason, but we see from our experience and from the discussion from the science that we see there that it may be an update bug, we throw out an article like this one. A name of link, that's one of the SQL Server examples, one of the latest bugs. And I immediately wrote an article about it with a bit of information about a description and the cause that we had very quickly in the forums and about the current status. And the point is that we were at least 1 week quicker than Microsoft. And this can be very important if the whole company stands still. You a week is a lot of time. And then some workarounds, that's the next goal, to present some workarounds that people find in the forums, that we find in our trials here and in trying to reproduce the bug and to inform people as quick as possible. That's the first goal that we have with this AccessForever.org. Yeah, by the way, of course, the site title is program AccessForever.org. The second thing we want to reach with this website is to collaborate with the Access team. All this is not against Microsoft, because only the Access team can really fix a bug. We can present workarounds, but not fix it. So we try to accelerate things also in this direction. We ask people to provide us with reproduction scenarios of files, and we transfer them to Microsoft, to the people at the Access team, and to get quicker fixes, to get quicker reproduction scenarios, etc. With the last three update bugs, we had some success in this direction. So we could accelerate. It's hard to say. Some days, was it a week maybe, that things got quicker. Also the fixes coming out quicker. So we had little successes, at least with these three things here. The first two here, this was in November, that's the third one here. December and January, so the latest update bugs, these three here. And the last one here is still open because the first two here were problems that the Access team could solve. The third one here is a Windows problem. And as I already mentioned, this takes some weeks longer until a fix comes out. But we are pressing. We are reminding Microsoft that they don't forget about these bugs. So, this slide is about what can you do if you think at, your problem might be a regression. Usually it's there was an update by Microsoft, and the next day your Access application doesn't work anymore, or something in the application doesn't work anymore. What can you do? That should be your things to do, your checklist. The first one is try to check and investigate if it's really an update bug. So try it with a new database, with a different machine, and the most important thing, try it with an older build of Access and Office. So if you don't change anything on the machines, etc., but just go back one or two builds, And it works, and you go up again, and it doesn't work. It's a strong evidence for an update bug. And don't spend too much time. I mean, in the forums, we often have discussions about bugs, and then people come in and say, oh, since weeks, I'm wondering what this may be. That's the wrong approach. Try it for a few hours, then go into first into our webpage now, and the new Access Forever, or go to the Microsoft bug page. Maybe you'll find some information. Go into the forums. There are Microsoft forums. This is a little German one for me, but there are big Microsoft forums and other forums out there with MVPs, sometimes even with answers from the Access team. And these are the best sources, of course, because the Access team is the Access team, and MVPs have a direct way to communicate with them. And don't mix them up with these Microsoft agents that you might see in the forums. They are nice people and they have a lot of links, but they are not deep in the product. So try to get answers by Microsoft Access team members or by MVPs at least. And it's about information, of course, about the bugs and about the first workarounds, etc., that you get normally quite quickly in forums. So this could should be your plan if you think you got a regression on your machines. Any questions so far, George?
Yes, I have two in here. The first one, as far as you know, does Access suffer more from update bugs than some of the other Office applications, or is it pretty evenly spread?
I'm not really sure. I'm not enough in other products. Can't say.
Thank you.
Would have to ask Microsoft.
Okay. And the next question is there a current Access Manager at Microsoft?
That comes later in another chapter.
Okay.
I have some slides about it.
Okay, great. So, that's it.
There were not only bugs, there were also some new features. So now the positive thing, almost. What did we get from Microsoft? Also a few new features. Last May, we got the Dataverse connector, finally, because for 2 years, they only, or mainly the Access team worked on the Dataverse connector. All the other updates or new features we have waited for so long were shifted for almost 2 years. And now it's out since May, and we don't see it. I mean, there are maybe one or two questions per month in the forum about Dataverse, and question is, who uses it? I mean, this is an article I wrote a year ago about who will use the Dataverse connector, in my point of view. And I think it's mainly the big corporations, the big customers, and not really the traditional Access market, but more the big companies that already may have Dynamics or another form of the Power Platform and the Power Platform apps, and they have that 10,000 Access databases somewhere sitting in their stores and in their offices. I think that's the main client for this, and maybe that's the reason why we don't see it a lot in the Access forums. I don't know. The next feature, under parenthesis, was it's a security feature from Microsoft's view. They blocked us the macro files, so the files that contain VBA, and that's for all of Office, also for Excel and Word, etc., and for Access. If you have a download from somewhere in the web, it's blocked by default, even if it's in a zip file, etc. And just mention it as a security feature we got from Microsoft, and it started in April and went over all of 22. They rolled it out one after the other, and there are some remedies linked here, because otherwise you have to click right on every single file and allow it, etc. There are other ways, policies, etc., etc., and there are some links for workarounds. A real new feature, a bit of parenthesis still, because it was 15 years overdue, but we got code signing. We got code signing back in January, so a new feature in this year even. You could do code signing with MDBs all the time, and the Excel people could do code signing, Word, etc. Code signing was possible, but we couldn't do it for the new format since 2007, so 15 years ago, ActDB and ActDE. It wasn't possible to do code signing, and we had the trusted locations. The point is to not get all these warning messages. And now it was urgent because of this feature here. More and more of these warning features came up because of the blocked microfiles, and they had to do something also for access. And so they accelerated it and then shipped it in January that we can do digital signature if trusted locations are forbidden. It can be big companies, etc., they don't like trusted locations, or you can't even use it. And in these cases, you can now do a digital signature to send them your files, access files. The next planned feature is the new web browser control. And sensationally, it's even in the roadmap, the official Microsoft 365 roadmap. The single point for access here is, if you filter for access, there's one point, the modern web browser control. It shall and hopefully will ship in March. So it's 2 years or so overdue, but we will finally get it. Maybe at the next DEF CON in April, they will present it. I hope so, the final version. This will be the next feature we get from the access team. Hopefully, really in March, we'll see. So this is the edge-based thing, because the old one is Explorer-based, etc., and we get the new one now, and waiting for it more than 2 years. Now AFO is the abbreviation for Access Forever org, and I have some plans in mind also about features, and my plans are different. Usually you throw some feature requirements, requests to Microsoft, but the access team is small, and you see we get maybe two features a year or so. I think it's not very realistic to pose your feature requests to Microsoft anymore for access. You will not get many of them. So my point of view for this year, and what I will try to do this year in 23 and to start it at least, is to improve the status of organization of third-party tool providers for access. There are many out there, and many features, many tools, almost everybody could use if they were easier to get, if they would have more visibility and an easier availability for you as access user or as developer. This is something I wanna do via the new website here. And what I mean is, I'm not sure today what kind of service this will be. Will it be an add-in, a website, a catalog of tools? Kevin Bell, whom you might know, a few years ago at my Access conference, threw in an idea of an Access package manager, a kind of NuGet, if you know it from .NET. NuGet works if you are programming in .NET and you need anything. You type it in the search, and NuGet tells you what is available in tools from third-party providers or whomever, and you get a link, you download it, you even install it. I mean, that's fiction for access. We will not get that far, but a part of this service I would like to have in access, even if it's only an add-in, or maybe we can get something from the access team. Also think that I try a link at least to this service. And if you think of the potential features we could get from third-party providers, from the community, Global Find and Replace, a friend of mine, a German one, has this tool. Editors like Ribbon Editor, Context Menu, SQL Editor, I know all the people who provide them. Analysis Tools, Luke Chung, Mail Tools, Luke Chung, Version Checker, Colin Riddington, Jason Handler, Colin, a Test Data Creator, I know a Dutch product, Image Tools, etc., etc. So there is an awful lot of tools out there which would be ready and available for people if it would be easier to see them and to get them. And that's the plan for this year, just to mention it. And I want to start a discussion with your ideas, and maybe if you find it good, work with us on this plan. That's my point here. Are there other questions, George?
Yes, a couple. First of all, there's a comment that the new Edge browser control that you mentioned is currently in the current channel preview on version 2302.
Yeah, in the preview channel. But if there comes a bug up, it may last a few weeks longer. Sure. You never know. Yep.
Yes. There's a question about, I think this is related to add-ins and so forth, would be GitHub. The question is, would GitHub be an option? I think it's related to the add-ins.
Yeah, only part of an option. What I want to have is more visibility inside the product. So we have to do something in Access to get it from there, to get go to a website, to go to a download or whatever, to an informational page where you see what is available, what does it cost, how do you get it, how do you install it, etc. So GitHub is, I don't like GitHub very much to say the truth, because I don't see it as an easy to use website for normal Access users, for example. It's difficult to find the important information at GitHub, my point of view.
Great.
Could be part of a solution, yeah.
Great, thank you. Two more questions. It's a question about FMS tools working in 2019, but not Access 365.
You have to ask Luke Chang, not me. Okay. But they should work.
Great.
So and, ask FMS.
Okay, thank you. And last question is, has there been any discussion about open sourcing some of the Access code base?
I don't think that it's realistic in the next years, because I mentioned and showed you that Microsoft guarantees for the last perpetual version 5 years. So it's one of my long-term ideas to get something like this, but in the next years, I don't see this.
Great, thank you. Those are all the questions for now.
Okay, next thing is about Microsoft websites. How do they treat Access on their websites? This is about the roadmap here. We had a roadmap in M365 for all the products, and we had it also for Access. And this was the roadmap last June, not the red part. The red part here is from me, from my videos where I showed this. And I always showed in my Access News videos how many years did they postpone these features. And you see the Microsoft Graph Data Connector, I even don't remember when I first saw it in 15 or 16 or so several years ago. And they couldn't keep the plans here and couldn't keep the dates. And they always saw it, me nagging, and of course many other people asked them, why don't you stick to your plans? And the reaction was not to accelerate things, but to get them off and pull them off from the roadmap. Party poopers. And what they instead did, Michael Aldridge, the PM at that time for Access, wrote that from now on, we will only have features in the roadmap where we have 90% confidence that we will really shipping them in the month listed. And that's why we hadn't any feature in the roadmap for half a year or so in the last half year. But what they did instead is they put out in their team blog an article about their priorities in engineering. This is the last one here. It goes, by the way, just to remember, you always have the link up there and you will get the slides. I will send them to George, to this article in this case. It lasts until March, so there should come out soon the next one. We hope so. And you see that the focus is essentially posting the fixes that they did. The second one here is the inconsistent database error that we have for more than 4 years now, 4.5 years. I call it a monster bug, and we don't get a fix. So number two doesn't work in the next months, I think. The new macro signing, we got it in January. The web browser hopefully comes in March, the final version. And they did some work for Dataverse, but I'm not sure if they did all these points here. So these are the engineering priorities until March. And there are some things missing that we had on the roadmap before, like a large address aware, the Monaco editor, or the graph connector. I'm not sure if anybody's waiting on the graph connector, but the other points, Monaco editor, that would be a new editor for SQL in Access, and LAA, large address aware, would be a memory extension for 32-bit applications and Access. And we are waiting for these points since years. And I asked the Access team, what's with this point? And they said, it's just not in the next months. It's still on the backlog, but not for the next month. So that's the the answer to this one. And a positive point, what they did is to post a list of the fixes every month since last May or June. They posted on in their blog, again, the link here, a list of fixes. And the problem with this, again, is that it's not easy to search them, to find them. And so here you see two links of articles I did for AccessForever.org. I just summarized the things they did in 22, and I also started it for 23, just that you see it and you can search on our site here so that you see what they did last year and what they started this year. I already did a new article and it's searchable, it's findable. And you have the links there to the details on their blog. By the way, the Access Team blog, it just consists of bug fixes. All these last 12 points were about roadmap and bug fixes. So there is it's a lack of positive and new features things. So even the digital signing thing, they didn't post any article. We posted an article on AccessForever.org. I wrote one, but here there's nothing to find. It's just the bug fixes. I mean, that's okay. It's interesting, but we need more positive news also from Microsoft that they are developing new features. You don't see them here in their blog. That's a problem with PR again. Another thing is User Voice. You may remember User Voice was a big portal from a third-party provider where you could throw in your requests to Microsoft about features, etc. And it was a third-party tool, so they put it off and now have their own thing, a feedback portal of Microsoft. But it's completely useless in my point of view. It's full of crap. I mean, the first things here are okay, but not very realistic in my point of view. Put Visual Code into Access instead of the IDE from VBA. That's a nice wish. We won't see it in the next years. But it's okay. But there's a lot of spam in there and no responses at all from Microsoft. I think it's, it's opium for the masses, as Karl Marx would say, but we don't see any result from this one. I think nobody looks at it a lot. If you go to Google and put in what's new in Access, this is the first hit that you get. That's the what's new page for Access. And here's the link, etc. And you get this one here. And it says the last feature that we have in Access is the add tables pane. Add tables with a few clicks. The problem with this is it's from, and it says there was nothing new in version blah, blah, blah in September. We are talking about September 20, 2.5 years ago. This was a new feature. It was in June. It was added in June 20. So there is nothing about the Dataverse connector, nothing about digital signatures, etc. There were a lot, but several new features. So completely outdated. And this is what you get if you type in what's new in Access or new features in Access. This is the landing page of Microsoft. So they are not able to update this. That's the PR they do for Access. Next one. If you go to the landing page, I already was there. This, if you type in Microsoft Access in Google, this is your landing page. And I was there a few slides ago to show you there's some PR. But at the end of this page, there is this sentence, Microsoft Access 2019 is the latest version of Access available as a one-time purchase. Huh? I mean, since more than 2 years, we have 2 years, we have a 21 and you can buy it as a one-time purchase. So even the most important landing page for Access is out of date. It's not under the current state. So this is the way how they treat Access on their pages. It's a sad story. Or another example, if what we always get very often in the forums, people have Microsoft 365 Family or some other subscription, and they ask us, where is Access? Is it in this subscription and where can I find it? The information is not easy to get. If you go to the family page, that's the main tool information and application information on the family page, you see this. The premium value is Word, Excel, PowerPoint, blah, blah, blah. And there's a link down there. Don't see the application you need. And if you click on Explore All Options, it goes round and around. You will never see Access. What you have to do is go several yards or meters down on this webpage. And then finally, you may find this one, summary of benefits. And the last point here is access is also included, even publishers. And nobody uses publisher anymore. it's before access here. Yeah, so this is the way, and we always have to point them to this far below point where they can see that access is in almost every Microsoft 365 subscription plan. So this was about Microsoft PR and websites. Any questions to this?
Yeah, perhaps more of a comment that you could add your thoughts on, but there was a comment that tool vendors also need more API support from access. And there's an example of a source code control that cannot detect a module being edited in the VBA editor.
Actually, this was a subject on one of my German conferences where Michael Aldrich, the product manager, was present, and we tried to form a group of third-party providers and to discuss these technical things with the Microsoft team, and then Michael went away, so we didn't succeed. I come to the personnel exactly at this point. The changes at Microsoft in the access personnel and the product manager. First, we had Michal Barr as program manager, and we had a change in 2020 to Evo Kwanzaa. Evo was great, but he changed. In 21, we had a change from Evo Kwanzaa to Michael Aldrich. And in 22, we had a change from Michael Aldrich to so far nobody. So there is not even a program manager for all these things that I mentioned before, for the PR work, for the websites, for communicating with us. There is just the engineering group in the moment, and we are still waiting on a new program manager to address our needs and our discussions, etc. So there's a difficult, you know that Microsoft had 10,000 layoffs in the last week, so it's not becoming easier, and cutbacks in the budgets, etc. So we hope that we will see a new program manager soon, but in the moment there's nobody since October when Michael went away from this group. So that's also a little difficult from the personal and position. Next point here is about some statistics that, because you don't find any real statistics in the web about access and access usage. What you find is what was asked in Google, how many times was Access or Oracle and SQL Server, et cetera, asked in Google or in some threads, in some forums. And above of that, they build some statistics about the usage of Access. I think that's nonsense. That doesn't tell anything about Access. As I mentioned before, why are no people in the forums, et cetera? You will find Access usually far below there because there's no new features, et cetera, no things to discuss and ask. So where is a place where you can find at least some Access versions and some statistics about Access versions? You find them at my conferences because I do the German conference 25 years this year. And I always ask people in big questionnaires about their usage of Access. And this time I show you the last 5 years of usage, and I ask them, what do you see and what do you work with at clients, at your studio, what Access versions do you use? And this is the answer. The dark blue here is from last October, so very new data here. The last 5 years of usage of Access, and I usually get more than 100 answers here, 150, it depends on the kind of conference, but it's at least representative for the European market, I would say, of Access developers. And this is what we see there. There's no surprise that the old versions go down, but there are some things in particular. For example, Access 2010 went down, but now it seems to be quite a slower going down. And this 40 here means that 40% of all developers at my conference there even still use Access 2010 in one or the for the one or the other application. By the way, you get more than 100% here with every column because almost every Access developer works with two or three or even more versions. That's why you get more than 100%. But this means 40% still work in one or the other way with 2010. And you see that 2013 was never as popular as 2010, or 2016 was high up and now goes down because, of course, 2019 came and it stagnates now because 2021 came up. Or another thing you see here is that the first year of 21 was about 7-8% of people use it. And you see the first year of 2019, it's doubled. So it had a far better start than 21. And what you see as 365 is it always goes up. This last year here, I don't know if it's a statistical outlier, maybe just would have to see next year. But it's, as you see on the next slide here, it's leading because this is the same data, but in years. So in 2018 and 19, you see the green here, that's 2010 was leading. In 2020, the version 2016 took over the lead and 365 was came in second and 2010 was only third. Then in 21, 365 finally took over the lead. I mean, since 10 years or so, we only see PR and advertisements for people take the 365 plans, don't take perpetual versions. They needed 10 years or so to get the win here, to go to the top and used access versions at developers at Europe, at least at our conferences here. And I think it's not so wrong for also for other, because you just change your access if you need to. Usually if it runs well, don't touch it. Yeah. And you see that it's the same here in the last year, 365 was up in 2021, then came in 2019 and then 2016 and 2010 at about 40%. So that's the thing I see in the versions here. And another questions I always put to them is to which percentage do you use access files as backends, MDBs or SSIDBs? And you see the last 10 years, it was always between 40 or 50%. So these are mainly professional developers, or at least developers that really seriously work with access that come to my conferences. And you see that almost half of their projects, they do with access backends. Only in the last year, we had a decline to about 35%. And question is it a statistical outlier that the access backends went down, or is it of a consequence of the many update bugs that we had with access backends? I don't know. We have to wait another year, maybe. By the way, always the questions come up. What do they use instead? I also ask that people, and usually it's almost the same amount that people use SQL Server and Access backends, and then about 10% come in with other backends like Oracle or MySQL, etc., Postgres and whatever exists. So it's almost half, also about 40% use Access backends in their projects and 40% SQL Server at the professional level here. Are there any questions, George?
Yes, one question on that last slide, is that percentage of applications or percentage of developers?
The question is, to what degree do you use, to what percentage do you use Access as a backend? So that's the result of that question.
I
use it for 45%, et cetera, and that's the overall average of 150 people or so.
Thank you.
And by the way, the other thing here is the front end. So you see people who use Access almost exclusively, the blue one, use Access as front end tool, 80 to 90%. You can do everything with Access. That's the thing that we see here. The last big thing the last chapter here is community and initiatives. What happened last year? The most important thing are my my videos. Every 3 or 4 months, when I have the time, I throw out another video about Access news. And you see these pictures here, it's very factual, very strict about just the databases, etc., what I do here, and tell you about the latest developments, etc., in the last months. And I'm working on the next video on Access News 5 this time. So this is one new thing in the last year. The next, I do the only conferences as it looks for Access. And the next one, the English one, is in April 27 and 28. So if you are interested in more information, professional information about Access development, you get the link here. And we do it virtually in Teams. And I have two co-presenters. That's Philipp Stiefel and Peter Döring again, who helped me to moderate the thing. And these are some topics we will have there, but it's better if we go to the beta version of the website that will come up in the next days. We will have an update by the Access team about the new features and their plans. Mike Wolf will do two things, an update about Twin Basic that I will mention in the next slide, and about defensive programming. Colin Riddington will show the newest features of his free tool to do automatic form resizing. He's always coming out with new features, and Chris Long will show you how to draw gadgets on your access reports to show data in a nicer way, in a more colorful way. And this guy here, George Young, will present about putting your access, complete access applications and your VBA into an Azure VM. So, and there will be many more sessions, but I'm still currently working on the agenda. So these are just the first things that we will have there. So this will be at the next Access conference, and many things more, like about documentation and example apps and tools, etc. And I think I hope to start registration next week and to put up a broader agenda. And to end, or almost end, with a positive outlook, is I want to talk a bit about Twin Basic. I mean, I think everybody in the meantime has heard about Twin Basic. We try to promote it at every event that I organize. Twin Basic is a project by Wayne Phillips. You may know him. He's the guy behind Everything Access Org. He is the only one who can convert MDEs and ACTEs back to ACTEPs, and he does it really well. And he has an error tool that does general error handling, etc. So he knows many things and very deep about access. And so he's really, he's a little genius, and big genius. And he does Twin Basic. That's a new version of, in the moment, Visual Basic 6, I would say, what he does in the moment. It's the beta version is out since 21, and we will see the final version 1 this year, later this year. It was planned for April, but he had some problems and shifted it to summer, but we will see it this year. And his goal is to be 100% compatible to VB6 and VBA, but with an awful lot of new features. So he modernizes VB6, in this case, about 15 or 20 years or so, with new comments, with things you only may know from .NET programming, multi-threading, things we never really could use in Visual Basic. And he will have some different versions out, and the ultimate version will even support Linux, Mac OS, and Android. So you can create EXE files also for these platforms. And it's a commercial project, but he gives away for free the 32-bit version, and the ultimate costs about 45 euros or dollars. You can subscribe already to the plan. Many people have subscribed to support him in his efforts. And this is an example of the UI of the interface of Twin Basic, which is looks just from the first look looks very modern. And I did an interview with Wayne, the first interview that you will see with Wayne Phillips, and of course I asked him about Access and Office. We will see something from your work there, and he said yes. He will integrate Twin Basic into Access and Office VBA starting in late 23, and I think we will see things at least in 24. And the first thing he's planning is to integrate the code editor, and he said he has further big plans. Not going into details, but we will see something of Twin Basic also as VBA developers and as Access developers. That's his plan, and maybe this is what we will see as a future of VBA. I hope so, but this is a big chance. So what I wanted to provide here is also a positive view. There are people who are really doing something. Not many things come from Microsoft. We get many things from the community and from third-party providers, and this is a really big thing, Twin Basic. Well, Ma, are there any questions, George?
No additional questions in the chat window yet.
Okay. So the final point is access went 30 in October, and maybe you noticed, and that's a picture of Arvin Meyer took once at the Walk of Fame on the Microsoft campus in Redmond. And if you can't read it, it was shipped in October 28 of 92. So we are at more than 30 years. And to this occasion, I wrote a little song, the Access song. And now we come to a world premiere here. Yesterday, I wrote the second verse of the Access song, and I will try to perform it right now. I stop sharing because you can see that I play live here. At least I'll try. And I have to change the microphone for a moment. I hope you can hear something.
We pick this one. Can you still hear me, George?
Yes, loud and clear.
Okay. So I put off my headphones and I will sing you a little Access song. Small business and departments is where they value what Access is. Some thousand files of Excel, just hundreds of ACTBs. IT and admins hate it because it's everywhere. Agility and chaos, there's no control to be fair. This is the Access song, the Microsoft Access song. Though it's not a beauty, it's versatile and strong. Let's sing the Access song, the Microsoft Access song. 30 years of duty, many more to come. So this is how I will end my session for today.
Carl, I hope when the big record companies come to offer you a recording contract, you will still have time for Access.
It's just three chords because I wanted it to go up in the chart. You don't have to put in more than three chords.
So well, great. Thank you so much. That was excellent.
You're welcome. It's a 70 minutes. I think that's still acceptable. Yeah.